Dr. Frank Lin, thank you so much for being here on Public Health On Call.
Thanks for having me, Lindsay.
So today we're going to talk about hearing loss. Mm-hmm. So where do we start?
So hearing, or the flip side of hearing loss, right? It's I think it's something we all take for granted, right? It's one of the sort of the five senses that our brain depends on, right? And the amazing thing about hearing is as much as we rely on it for everything we do, for communicate, talking, hearing a car come down the road, it's something that declines for everybody as we get older. And that's because, interesting, compared to other senses in the body, other systems in the body, the inner ear, called the cochlea, it can't regenerate. So everybody, no matter what you do, no matter who you are, no matter what you even try to do in terms of hearing protection, everybody's hearing will slowly, bit by bit, decline over your lifetime. So I think in the past, it's always been sort of taken for granted. It's like, oh, just grandma or my mom having hearing loss, and it doesn't really matter. But increasing over the last 10, 15 years has been borne out that's actually not quite true, because it's so fundamental to the brain. We understand that as hearing declines for all of us to some degree, it actually impacts our health.
And how does it impact our health?
So I think the big thing is if you look at the data, so I think empirically, so you know, the other hat I wear besides being a public health scientist, I'm actually an ENT surgeon. So I see patients who have hearing problems coming for issues. And it's something I think you talk to any clinician, they're like, oh yeah, it affects social function. It affects how people think. They get tired. Their kids complain. They're not like their usual selves. They don't seem to be as quick as they used to be. But that was never really borne out by evidence, because no one had ever really done literally the research, just asking, you know, from purely from epidemiologic perspective, really basic, you know, hearing or hearing loss is your exposure. And you look at outcomes like cognitive and brain function, brain aging, brain structural changes, falls. It's a very basic question. But no one really asked those questions until about a decade ago, because I think it was always like, again, just, oh, it's hearing loss, doesn't really matter. It's just like getting some white hair. So we actually began that research about 10, 15 years ago with many other groups around the world. Just people began sort of crossing silos. People think about hearing, didn't think about the sort of other stuff about aging and health. People started about aging and health, didn't think much about hearing. But if you actually look at that data, you see that hearing loss or hearing is arguably the single largest risk factor for dementia at the population level, because there's how common hearing loss is and how strong the relationship is. But you also see relationship between hearing and falls, between risk of social isolation and loneliness, all these things that I think for all of us, as any of us just get older, we care about. And increase, I think it's the important thing about that too, it's not just, there's always notion as a correlation or causation, right? And correlation wouldn't be very interesting. It's just like saying like white hair is linked with dementia. Sure it is, but it doesn't really matter. Increasing awareness, it's not just correlation, that like is causation for how hearing affects the brain in terms of how much harder the brain has to work, and or it leads to faster rates of brain atrophy, and or through just the loss of sort of social connectedness. That's incredibly important for maintaining our health as we get older.
So what do you do about it?
So I think in the past, it was always like, we had this wonderful evidence that hearing was important. And then recently, actually, after almost a decade of work with funding from the National Institute on Aging, we actually had a trial, a randomized trial that tested if you treat hearing loss in older adults, do you in fact make a difference? Do you, for example, reduce things like cognitive decline? Lo and behold, after many, many years of funding, after this 1,000-person randomized trial carried out throughout the United States, we actually know the answer to that now. Namely, for older adults at risk of cognitive decline, if you actually address and you treat your hearing, it actually reduces the rate of loss of thinking memory abilities by almost 50%. So it's not insignificant. So there's wonderful evidence. That's great. But a big issue in the past then was, I think all of us probably know, hearing aids are really expensive. The average cost in the States used to be about $4,000, which amazingly, that means for the average American, it could be your third largest material purchase life after a house and a car, which is just absurd, right? We've changed that. So over a period of many years, working with the National Academies of Medicine, working with Congress, working with the White House, we got a law passed 7 years ago now that re-regulated hearing aids that went into effect just 2 years ago. So hearing aids, for the first time ever now in the U.S., the first country in the world to have a regulated market of over-the-counter hearing aids, it's driving innovation and, I would say, accessibility at scale. Case in point, Apple. Right? Apple, one of the most valuable companies in the world, they have just announced as of 2 months ago, and it went into effect just a month ago, AirPod Pros can do your hearing test and they can serve as hearing aids. And AirPod Pros, I think, are $200. So it's increasingly, it's driving innovation with the right type of regulations. So that's great. So you have, now we have wonderful evidence that hearing matters, that treating can make a big difference as all of us get as older. We have the most wonderful policy in the United States that can drive innovation with companies like Apple entering the market. But the third big missing piece, though, is if no one actually knows their hearing, it doesn't really matter. And the example I give here all the time is, I would say if we ask most people out there, and I won't ask you, Lindsay, but like the last time most people got their hearing tested was probably when they're 7 years old in primary school. So we have all this evidence that hearing's matter, hearing's important. We have all this wonderful technologies coming up from companies like Apple, but no one knows their hearing what gives. So the third major thing we're working on is this whole fundamental issue of awareness, which is, you know, just completely germane to all public health. You have to have awareness of the issue before people can do about it. And the way we're going about that is actually we actually create an app called the Hearing Number app. It's completely free. It's made by the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. And it actually tells consumers, if you take this, you download this app, takes about 5 minutes to do the test, you actually learn your hearing number. And all the hearing number is a fancy way of saying it's the softest speech sound you can hear. So kids can have numbers as low as negative 10 decibels, super soft. That number will increase as we get older. But in the past, people never really had a number to tie to their hearing. It's just like you're told, oh, you have good hearing or you have hearing loss. But we don't say the same things for, let's say, like weight or blood pressure or your cholesterol. Your cholesterol is good or bad, or it's, you know, people have numbers to attribute to. We never had that for hearing, at least from the public sense. We always had that clinically, but we never really gave out the number. I don't know why. But increasingly now, consumers can get the number themselves. I think it becomes incredibly powerful as you think about hearing as being this metric of your lifetime that you follow over your life course, much like any other metric of your health or wellness that you may follow already.
So I'm gonna cut through the noise a little bit here and say that I cheated ahead of our conversation. And I did use the app and find out my hearing number, which I won't necessarily share that number here. But no, I'm just kidding. I think it was like 13. Yeah. Okay. So so what does that mean for me?
Yeah. So we are in the same boat. My hearing number is a 10 in my left ear, 12 in my right ear, which if we use the classic definitions of quote unquote hearing loss, the World Health Organization established years ago, right? Technically by the WHO, I should say technically, but this is what it is. If your hearing numbers, the softest sounding you hear is better than 20 decibels, that's considered quote unquote normal hearing. If it's between 20 and 34, it's mild hearing loss, 35 to 50 is moderate hearing loss, et cetera, right? So both you and I, Lindsay, we fall in the normal hearing category, good for us. But the amazing thing about that, the reason why the number is so powerful, is that if you had asked me a few years ago, Frank, how's your hearing? I've been studying my hearing my whole life. I'd be like, oh, my hearing's great, right? And actually, you know, literally the first time, it's crazy for me to say this, the first time I ever got my hearing measured was 3 years ago when I did this app on my phone that was available at the time through the iOS. It's called Mimi. You can actually get your hearing number that way. And this is literally the first time I ever had a hearing test done in my entire life, despite the fact that I am a board certified otologic surgeons who are known for my work on hearing and treating hearing loss. It's just crazy for me to say that, but it was the first I ever had my hearing test. But anyway, case in point, when I got that hearing number, I was like, oh, my hearing's great. It's also called the four frequency pure tone average between around 10 and 12. I was like very proud of myself. And then on a lark a few months later, I'm like, Audrey, my daughter was 16 years old at the time. I'm like, Audrey, you know, do you mind just, you know, do it yourself? And when she got her results back, her results were a negative 5.
That's a big difference.
Yeah, yeah. And when I saw that, I was like, oh, I guess I really am 30 years older than you, right? Mm. Because when I use as a proxy for myself, which is probably not unfair, my hearing has shifted from negative 5 back then to 10, where it roughly is now. And if I think about it enough, actually, I know for a fact if I'm in a busy restaurant with my daughter, she hears better than I do. I'm struggling just a bit more. I lean in a bit more. And it's because my hearing has shifted 15 decibels in 30 years, which is completely appropriate. But if you ever thought about clinically classically within my hearing, I would be considered normal, and hence, I don't need to do anything. And all of a sudden, one day, I would cross over this magical threshold of 20 decibels, and all of a sudden, I'd be told I have a mild hearing loss. It doesn't make sense how we treat it, finally, a quantitative concept qualitatively with essentially arbitrary categories. So with a hearing number 10, I mean, for me, I'll tell you, in general, when you say hearing numbers between roughly 10 and about 50 to 60, that's in the range where you could even consider OTC hearing aids. And what I mean by that, like, it's crazy for me to say this. Ever since Apple released their hearing aid feature, I've actually turned mine on my AirPod Pros, and there's something called Conversation Boost, basically just a directional microphone. It tunes into whoever's in front of you. And I've actually started using it. So if I'm in a busy enough restaurant, like really loud cocktail party type of restaurant, I literally put these AirPods in, and whoever I'm looking at, it makes it easier for me to hear, right? And I don't use them elsewhere for that purpose. It's just only in those situations. But it's amazing for me when you make these technologies accessible, all of a sudden, you know, I'm 48 years old. Am I a hearing aid user? I guess technically I am, right? So all of a sudden, it makes these technologies to actually just augment your life, augment your hearing, to hear better, which is what I think anyone wants to do. it's not all of a sudden this cliff you have to jump off of when you're like 70 years old and now you have to finally admit you're a hearing aid user, right? It's one of those things that as you can, people think about their hearing as a just a continuum of a lifetime. These technologies are accessible, they're in your pocket already. It changes the dynamics of how you think about optimizing your hearing across your lifetime. And I think the important thing about the idea of optimizing hearing is you're fundamentally talking about optimizing your health, given that hearing subserves everything we do on a daily basis.
I was going to ask you if, you know, doing what sounds like a little bit of an intervention early on, does mm-hmm. that actually help, you know, I guess, preserve some of your hearing or preserve some of that cognitive function?
So the scientific answer to that is we don't know, right? You know, that requires long-term epidemiologic studies, clinical trials, et cetera, et cetera. And listen, while I love science, it can also sometimes be just trumped by just common sense, right? I don't know a single condition involving health that it's not better to address it earlier, right? It just doesn't really exist. And especially, it's one thing if the quote-unquote intervention is risky and it costs a lot of money or it's just dangerous. That's another question. But I think when we're talking about using, you know, for example, for me, using my AirPod Pros, there's no risk with that. There's not even much financial risk. I already own them already anyway. So how could it not be beneficial in a way, right? So I think there's a common sense element in terms of thinking about what the intervention is in terms of risk-benefit calculus. You know, popping back to another thing you mentioned too, though, which is about like, well, how do we use this number? I'll tell you one really interesting thing is my, you know, I told you my daughter, her hearing number is a -5. And then she's a really close friend in college. She's in college now, she's 18 now. And his hearing number, even though they're the same age, his is an 18. And he's like, wait a minute, why is my hearing like worse than your dad's, right? And she tells me like he's much more conscious about it now when he's like in a bar. He's like, man, is it too loud here? Should I be using some hearing protection? So I think it's an element that I think for him, he would never have thought about his hearing. If he took any hearing test, like, oh, I have normal hearing, I'm good to go, right? But when you think about it conceptually, he's like, my hearing is literally worse than your 40-year-old dad's. And even though that's a normal hearing, 18 is considered normal. And it's like way worse than my daughter's. It raises element of awareness that's never there if you use a qualitative term, right, with that number. So I think even at for a, you know, like my daughter's age, her, you know, that level, which is not really worried about hearing, you can think about your hearing just in terms of protecting your hearing. I mean, like, you know, number one, I think the whole thing of public health is prevention is number one. If you can do that before you have to treat it. And, you know, for the thing with hearing, the main preventive thing you can really do for hearing is really just noise. Noise is accumulative over time. It's cumulatively damage your hearing over time. It's not one event necessarily. It's just accumulative over your lifetime. And the tricky thing about that is that every person has an individual susceptibility to noise. So one person's noise doesn't affect their hearing much as another person's, and there are a lot of genetic and other risk factors that link to that. We don't even know sometimes. But this idea then, if you track your own hearing, like any of the metrics, you track your own blood pressure, track your own weight, you can take the individual steps you need to do to protect and prevent something from occurring.
So you mentioned we've got, you know, new evidence, okay? We've got new technology and innovation. We now have an accessibility feature, like this is something anybody can use on their smartphone at any time. But there's one thing that you haven't mentioned.
Uh-oh.
And it kind of came to my mind when you were talking about your daughter and her friend being 18 and, you know, everybody might have a different hearing number, mm-hmm. Much like everybody might have different ability in sight. But yet we do early on these interventions with glasses and contacts. But the idea of, let's say your sight's really bad and you need glasses at an early age, like 7,
yeah.
Nobody thinks about if your hearing's really bad, you might need a hearing aid at age 25 or something.
Yeah.
There's a stigma factor here.
Oh,
can you talk
is.
A little bit about that?
Yeah, so stigma's a big one. And stigma's not one thing. It's, I think, tied with a lot of things. So one element is clearly change in hearing get worse, you get older. So there's definitely is clear ageist bias to it. Like by to admit you have a hearing loss is to admit you're old. To use a hearing aid is to definitely admit you're old. So there's that element of just fundamental ageism that underlies it. That's one thing. A second thing I'll say, a big one too, though, is that, and this is really true, when you put on a pair of like glasses, and assuming your vision, the most visual loss are just refractive, just the light rays can't bend properly. You put in a pair of glasses, it reflects, refracts the light properly and you can see perfectly again, right? So their glasses are in a way completely, not curative, but you know what I mean? They completely correct the issue. Hearing isn't like that. So when you put on a pair of hearing aids, I can assure you, if hearing aids completely restored your hearing perfectly again, back to like when you're a 10-year-old, everyone would wear them, right? hearing aids aren't like that, though. It's the equivalent of, let's say, the visual equivalent would be macular degeneration. There's been neural damage done to the back of the eye, per se. Nothing fits that perfectly. Hearing's the same way. There's actually been cumulative damage to the inner ear, so the sounds can't be sent properly to the brain. The main thing, let's say, any type of hearing technology does, it makes a sound come in clearer, so you're able to better accommodate for it, but it's not fixing it perfectly. So I think it's one thing too, is that the actual interventions themselves aren't perfect, right? Another element too, I think, of the sort of stigma angle too, is I think for a while, just hearing was considered not important necessarily. It's just getting older, just getting some white hair, it's no big deal. But I think that fortune is being turned over very, very quickly. The other aspect of the stigma, I think, is changing a lot too, is as these more really because of how we were to change regulations many years ago with, you know, working with Congress and the White House with these over-the-counter hearing aids from company, when a company like Apple enters a field, they set precedents, they send trends. I mean, for example, case in point, is that someone walking around with AirPods in the ear because there's walking around with AirPods in the ear, or it's because they're using the hearing aid? It's one and the same. So it's really allowing, I think this is really important, is convergence between what is a consumer technology, a hearable, wearable earbud versus a hearing aid. It's increasingly one and the same. And that makes it really, really cool because that clearly, you can imagine, reduces stigma to a great degree.
So we only have a couple of minutes left, but I want to ask you, first of all, where can people find this app? How do they use it? And then what do they do once they know their hearing number?
So, okay, the hearing number app is available on Android or iOS. Right now for Android, though, I think it's only available for Samsung and Google phones, but that will change very quickly in the future, and it's available for all iOS phones. You basically just go to Android Play Store or the Apple App Store. You search for the term hearing number and it should come right up. It's a completely free app. We don't collect any data. We're not monetizing at all. It's obviously from the School of Public Health. It's completely private. We don't collect any data. It takes about 5 minutes. You need to use a pair of headphones. You need to be in a reasonably quiet room, for example, just like in the bedroom of your house, for instance, or just somewhere relatively quiet. It's going to be fine. And then you'll hear different tones, and it will in the end, it'll result out your hearing number, which can be, again, as if you're like my daughter, as low as -5 or 10, all the way up to even 60, 70, 80, potentially, if you have quite a severe hearing loss. With that number, then, the app takes you through like what you may be experiencing in noise, inclusion, how to protect your hearing, right? In general, the rule of thumb for protecting your hearing is either move away from the sound or turn down if you can, or use a hearing protection. And from there, then with your hearing number, it can guide you to certain technologies. And the general rule of thumb is quite simple. If you're between, like, hearing number between 10 and 60 already, you can consider using some type of OTC hearing aid devices. For example, like me, I use it just incidentally when I'm at a really loud cocktail party or bar. But as your hearing number goes up, you might need to use it more regularly. If you're hearing between 20 and 90, that's in the range where you can just get a prescription hearing aids, right? There's a lot of crossover depending on what you want across between OTC hearing and prescription, 10 to 60 for OTC, prescription is 20 to 90. And then if your hearing numbers are above 60, which is quite severe, which is only about 1% of the population, you're actually in the range where you consider things like cochlear implants, which is basically it's a neuroprosthetic device, people who are still struggling with hearing despite even using a hearing aid. So the number of occlusion directly into the technologies that you can do throughout your life, beginning even my age, 48, to just help optimize your hearing across essentially your lifetimes. So it's not all of a sudden a big deal to all of a sudden admit you need a hearing aid when you're, 7 years old. You've been using something like that already for decades, possibly at that point.
Well, this has been a great conversation, and this is really important information. Thank you so much for being on Public Health On Call.
Oh, thanks for having me, Lindsay.